Mugabe calls on African leaders to emulate Nkrumah's ideals.
Parliament discusses the country's preparedness for the rainy season.
New 5-city note in circulation. Good evening and welcome to News Hour, live on GBC24 and Ghana Television. My name is Emmanuel Amagashi.
And I am Ofuriwa Adako. Welcome once again. In our first report, President Mr. Robert Mugabe says President Akufo-Addo is the man he can relate to. He told newsmen in Accra that Ghana's President Nana Akufo-Addo reinforces the ideals of Dr. Kwame Nkrumah, a quality he wishes to see in the current crop of African leaders.
President Robert Mugabe of Zimbabwe was in the country to participate in the Independence Day celebrations at the Black Star Square. He says he feels a special attachment to Ghana and hence sees himself as a Ghanaian. He schooled in Ghana at the Achimota School and taught for 2 years at Sekendi Takrade in the late 1950s. President Mugabe's first wife, Sally, was a Ghanaian.
I got married to Sally. She went to Achimota. She was a strong woman. She would get up and get. We have a program, we have a children's program, she a women's program this way, that way, and so on. Our nation recognized her. She lies at a place where we lay to rest our heroes. We call it the National Heroes Echo. She lies there as a national hero.
Mr. Mugabe was Zimbabwe's prime minister between 1980 and 1987. Since 1987 to date, Mr. Mugabe has been the sitting president of Zimbabwe. He said Ghana and Zimbabwe can share ideas on a number of issues.
I have not imposed myself upon my people. Elections freely. The other parties, we don't oppress any party. And it's the fact that they see in our party, you know, that Nkrumah principles, those principles which we developed from Nkrumah, the resources are there not for individuals, no, but for your own people. Not, we don't say leaders cannot have, you know, interests here and there. But when you're working for government, you must demonstrate truly that you are for the people.
According to President Mugabe, he was happy to be part of Ghana's celebrations. He said President Akufo-Addo has a passion for Africa's development.
That speech goes quite deep in history. The history Nkrumah used to tell us of his makings. And then reference to Nkrumah. Those quotes which every revolutionary in our part of the country. So I said, you made a wonderful speech. And I said that I think I could relate to him.
He hopes Ghana's 60 years of independence will be a turning point in the country's history.
The region now, where the region's industrial enclave within the Kumasi metropolis is fast losing its status as a center for jobs. This is due to the collapse of most of the companies in the last few years. Our Ashanti regional correspondent Nicholas Osewusu visited the enclave and has this report.
Industrialization was a key component of the wholly indigenous government of Ghana, led by Osagyefo Dr. Kwame Nkrumah. The Ashanti region was not left out in this drive, which was meant to create decent jobs for the residents, particularly the youth. Asokwa, Ahensan, Kase, Antosu and Chapatre were the communities that became what is known as the industrial area of Ashanti from the early 60s. The christening of this enclave as the industrial area was in appreciation of the numerous state and privately owned companies that were sited there. These communities fell within the present-day Asokwa constituency, which is in the western part of the metropolis. Ahensan is almost at the center of this enclave. Within the industrial area were notable state-owned enterprises such as the Jute Factory, Guinness Ghana, the Shoe Factory, and the Kumasi Brewery Limited. Also located within this industrial enclave are the Coca-Cola Bottling Company Limited, the Kumasi Abattoir, many sawmill businesses including the Locks and Lamba Limited, popularly called LLL, Africana Forester Sawmill, AE, Saud Company and Naja David Vinier and Plywood Limited. Dr. Kwame Nkrumah's government established the Jute Factory in the early 60s for the manufacture of jute sacks for the packaging of Ghana's dried cocoa beans for export. The Shoe Factory was manufacturing footwear for personnel of the security agencies and also for school children. The sawmill companies were also vibrant because of the abundance of timber resources within the region and beyond. Ahensan, one of the communities within the catchment of this industrial enclave. Nana Akosuafobi, the queen mother of this community, recalls some of the benefits the residents derived from these companies.
Yeah, community center says a wouldn't see my and no juma no ye were hanging tra. Ne ma obia near jumaye. A colacra co school. Ye ma a quire. With me co, ye jumaca cra, and ye scar, obey me the tria, the school fees. Ne macro no nay, never was was anyha. Send a juma a boo happy bree.
Within the last 20 years or less, these once vibrant and job creation avenues have collapsed. The queen mother of Ahensan, who lamented about the development, urged the government to rebuild the companies first before implementing the one district, one factory policy. Meanwhile, a wholly owned Ghanaian private company, the Jute Mills Limited, is rehabilitating the jute factory following its divestiture in the mid-1990s.
The rainy season may have started earlier than expected, with the capital already experiencing major flooding. The Ghana Meteorological Service has warned that the rains this year will be heavy. The Member of Parliament for Klote Kole, Dr. Zenato Ajimai Rollins, called for swift action to prevent any flood-related crisis this year. She was presenting a statement in Parliament on the country's preparedness for the rainy season.
Flooding has become an annual ritual in parts of the country, especially Accra. The problem is largely blamed on human attitude as people dispose of waste indiscriminately. Others build on waterways, while enforcement of the law on sanitation falls short. The Member of Parliament for Klote Kole, Dr. Zenato Ajimai Rollins, called for swift measures to forestall flood-related crises this season.
The collection of refuse by companies must be timely, and further processing of waste must be properly monitored. We should aim to recycle more and decrease the number of landfills in existence. As a matter of urgency, those of us in Parliament, with the help of the media, should advocate for behavioural change towards the environment and sanitation, in line with localising the Sustainable Development Goals number 3, which is related to good health and well-being, and number 6, clean water and sanitation. The safety and security of any community or country is not simply the absence of war. It also includes socio-economic, environmental and health factors.
I think, Mr. Speaker, that we as a House should reconsider the impact
of giving the National Sanitation Day some legislative backing in order to help address the floods that we experience.
The Member of Parliament for Nsawom Edwajiri, Mr. Frank Anodompre, also presented a statement on the role and importance of traditional medicine. He entreated government to help herbal medicine practitioners to improve their business.
Having come this far, even to the level of integrating and synchronizing the clinical herbal medicine practice into the main healthcare delivery system in Ghana since 2012, it is important that we ensure full enforcement and strict compliance of laws regulating traditional herbal medicine practice. I strongly suggest and advocate also that cost of services of traditional herbal medicine practitioners are absorbed or covered by the National Health Insurance Scheme, as most patients who patronize their services are card-bearing members and unable to afford payment. As government seeks to strengthen the NHIS, this call is well placed and timely. It is unfortunate that these service providers in the health delivery sector are left out.
The practice is not up to standard and well regulated. Mr. Speaker, I join the Honourable Member by calling on the regulatory agencies to ensure that we sanitize the situation or the scene and weed out the bad nuts, those who are making profit, excessive profit at the expense of our people, especially the poor and the vulnerable. This can only be done when we promulgate and ensure that Act 575 is really implemented.
My most practical interest is health tourism. Other nations are raking in a lot of jobs and monies by creating centers of excellence where their own plants are used to cure ailments. Let us rally around what we have and see what we can also do by giving it the support it deserves.
The recent clash in Kumasi between the police and students of the Kumasi Technical Institute was also raised. The Member of Parliament for Subing, Mr. Eugene Boachi Enki, in whose constituency the riot occurred, condemned the act and cautioned the parties involved to remain calm until investigations are complete. Earlier, a delegation from the Moroccan Parliament visited the House to study Ghana's parliamentary practice and to deepen relations between the West and Northern African Parliament. Sitting was adjourned to Wednesday, March 8, 2017.
The Minister for Gender, Children and Social Protection, Madame Otiko Efisa-Jaba, says Ghana has made strides in ending child marriage through education and other interventions. She was speaking at a meeting with UNICEF and UNFPA in Accra on how to completely end child marriage.
Child marriage is a global issue, and in Ghana, child marriage is illegal. The 1992 and 1998 Children's Act set the legal age for marriage at 18 for both girls and boys. However, child marriage still persists in parts of the country. Underlying factors such as poverty has been identified as one of the main causes of child marriage. Child marriage has serious implications for the socio-economic development of any country, as girls of school-going age miss skills, knowledge and employment opportunities. It also has dire consequences on their health. Representatives of UNICEF and UNFPA are in the country to fashion out a more innovative way of ending child marriage. The Minister for Gender, Children and Social Protection, Madame Otiku Afisa-Jaba, said all individuals and civil society groups must work together to fight the phenomenon.
If you have all these young girls getting married at 16, that means Ghana is not going to be productive. Because when a girl child becomes a child bride, when she becomes a mother before she's 18, what happens to her dream? What happens to her contribution to her family? what happens to her contribution to her community, to her region, to Ghana, and to global affairs. These young girls are what it is all about.
UNICEF and UNPFA are committed to ensuring that Ghana completely ends child marriage through innovative programs.
The world at this time has said we must end child marriage. We have come to Ghana because Ghana itself has made enormous progress towards ending child marriage. As early or as late as 20 years ago, one in every three Ghanaian girl and woman was married below the age of 18. And this has now reduced to one in every five girl and woman.
Child ambassadors Jeanette Kwati and Abigail Dogbe are championing the cause to end child marriage. The gender ministry said there would be subsequent engagements with stakeholders on ending child marriage.
We'll go to the Bunahafi region, where the Vice Chancellor of the University of Energy and Natural Resources, Professor Harrison Dapa, has appealed to the Education Service to increase the number of science-based senior high schools in the region. Professor Dapa said this will help produce more science-inclined students in the region.
Ghana is one of the countries that are scientifically deficient, so the University of Energy and Natural Resources has instituted the Science Festival for pupils and students to encourage the study of science. 15 schools from the Sinyani municipality have been selected for the maiden edition of the festival. As part of the festival, pupils and students will be taken through various programs like experiments in the lab, geological adventures, exploration of the solar system, and night sky viewing. They will also embark on trips to places of scientific interest like the Bui Hydroelectric Power Station. The coordinator of the science festival, Madame Camila Kaboom, said the festival is expected to help broaden the minds of future generations to seek scientific answers to life's challenges.
The problem is that our community here, there is no maybe enough examples how to use science and how to build own future on the base of the science. So this program, this science festival, this one, is just to start, is a test of this event. But we are going to have to repeat this every year, bringing kids even from the kindergarten up to senior high school.
The Vice Chancellor of the UENR, Professor Harrison Dapa, said the Science Festival will soon be rolling out science and mathematics clinics for female SHS students with deficiencies. He said the move is to mainstream gender, especially females, into science and engineering programs in the university.
Science education is very important because it gives you a very analytical mind. And then become more versatile and competitive. You can do science, you want to change to do business, you are allowed. But if you do arts, there's no way you can do any science, you can shift straight to science. And also, once you do science, you become more competitive, versatile, and you can even switch. And you need more science students who are even go to do law, so that when they go anywhere that they go, they will be able to apply the scientific principles.
The Foundation Vice Chancellor of the UENR, Professor Mrs. Isi Ewua, echoed the call for introduction of science programs to encourage students to develop interest in science.
And back to Accra, the Vice President, Dr. Mahamadou Bawumia, says Dr. Kwame Nkrumah's drive to liberate the continent of Africa from colonialism was also aimed at economic emancipation. This, according to Dr. Bawumia, can be achieved if Africans in the diaspora and at home joined forces to harness the potential of Africa. The Vice President said this when he joined African diasporans, including Lord Boateng of the British House of Lords, in the homecoming conference in Accra.
To many in the diaspora, Ghana is synonymous with the name Kwame Nkrumah. This is due to Dr. Kwame Nkrumah's contribution to the spreading the Pan-African flame across Africa and even beyond. And as Ghana marks a Diamond Jubilee, a conference is underway in Accra to discuss, among other things, the legacy of Dr. Kwame Nkrumah. He evoking the spirit of 1957 is the main theme, and this was eloquently done by Professor Atukwe Okain.
I speak to you from the schoolroom of the African soul. I do not come from Ghana. I was only born there. I do not come from Nigeria. Neither do I come from Zimbabwe. My soul was only conceived there. I do not come from South Africa. I do not come from Egypt. My spirit was only programmed there. I do not come from Madagascar. Neither do I come from Libya. My hair was only textured there. I do not come from Rwanda or the expansive Sahara. My structure was only geometricized there.
The Vice President, Dr. Bahamadu Bawumia, said the struggle for political freedom by Dr. Kwame Nkrumah and a host of others will be complete when Africa is no more economic dependent.
In economics, you tend to ignore, you know, issues like heritage and culture when you do policy. But we ignore that at our peril. We ignore that at our peril. Because heritage and culture is the one thing that nobody can really compete with you for in the world. It's a unique commodity to us. And it is something, therefore, that we have to hold very, very dearly and make sure that it shines through our struggle for economic development. And in this context, I think the link to our diaspora is very key to our development, because we are all part of the same family. And so if we are able to tap the human resources, the investment resources, the trade resources, science and technology that our brothers and sisters in the diaspora can bring, it is very, very clear that we can make a lot of strides and make up for that separation that took place during slavery and colonialism for the most part.
Later, a panel discussion was held on the legacy of Dr. Kwame Nkrumah and was moderated by Mr. David Ampofu.
My memory of Kwame Nkrumah was of a man who lived incredibly simply, but a man who always surrounded himself with people whose focus was activism and delivery. And that applied whether they were intellectuals, they were business people, whether they were in public administration. What his focus was is in what can you do to make a difference?
Initially, it was Pan-Africanism at the political level, independence for the colonies. And then after that, what do we do? How do we build the economy? How do we create jobs? How do we make sure that industrial setups are done and education is on course, health institutions and facilities are in place to take care of the populations? That part is the harder one.
Intellectual discourse and the role played by the forebears of African continent is still raging on, but now what is on the front burner are economic development, science and technology, and education and leadership. Edward Nyakun reporting for GBC 24.
And this is where we take a break. We are back with Bazi.
Good evening. My name is Maurice Ogbete. In business tonight, Chief Executive of DLS Finance, Ken Thompson, is predicting a further fall of the Ghana cedi in the days ahead. The cedi is trading against the US dollar at 4.70 pesos. Mr. Thompson said, the only way to reverse the trend is to change the structure of the Ghanaian economy from an import-dependent one to an export-led economy that earns foreign exchange to show the value of the local currency.
The cedi started 2017 at 4.30 pesos on the interbank foreign exchange market. But since then, the cedi's performance has taken a nosedive, falling to all the three major trading currencies, the US dollar, the pound sterling, and the euro. The cedi depreciated by 2.5% in value against the US dollar during election week to trade at 4.12 against the US dollar. Since January 1, 2016, the local currency had depreciated by about 9.95% to the American currency, and this was triggered by the election fever and the Christmas festivity. But since then, the Ghana cedi has not shown any improvement, selling at 4.70 pesos on the interbank currency market. Speaking at the Ghana Chamber of Commerce and Industry, the chief executive of Dalex Finance, Mr. Ken Thompson, said the cedi can further fall due to the poor economic fundamentals of the country.
First, we're given the masquerade, the Kakamotobi tax. Then we had some real taxes that we can take advantage of. But hang on, there's something we did not take into account. CD depreciation. The CD is sinking like a lead balloon, and it's been sinking like a lead balloon for years. If your foundation is weak, there's nothing you can do, but you have to pull the house down. Unless we solve the issue with supply and demand for the CD and the dollar, we're going nowhere. Look at this. June 2016. $3.95. January 2017, 4 cedis, 27. March, and maybe I'm not current, because I checked this rate last night. $4.72, 4 cedis, 72. Some people are quoting 4.78. Depreciation, 19.737%. Unless your costs are reducing by 19.3%, the value is not the same.
This view was supported by the head of finance department of the University of Ghana Business School, Professor Alufo Bukwin, but he said changing the structure of the economy will help strengthen the cedi.
We are importing everything. Why do you expect that the cedi will behave differently? Because the problem is not the cedi. The problem has nothing to do with the cedi. The cedi is only giving you a testimony to something happening. So what is happening to the cedi is a true reflection of what is happening at the fundamental level of our economy, the structure of our economy. So you may even add more heads to the currency note against one head, and it will not work. I hope that's okay. Because at that level, the competition is not the number of heads. It's about what is backing your currency. What is it that is backing the cedi? It's a small open economy where more than 70% of business input costs in this country is imported. How do you expect the cedi to behave differently? Certainly not. Until we look at the fundamentals, the cedi will continue to do what it has been doing. It has to adjust to reflect the new equilibrium. It's as simple as that.
The 2017 budget outlined policies that will help stabilize the cedi, including shoring up of exports and also reducing imports. This will be anchored on the establishment of one district, one factory policy, which aims at putting the economy on the path of industrialization.
And still in business, head of the finance department at the University of Ghana Business School, Professor Alufo Bukwin, has indicated that most of the targets set out in the 2017 budget are achievable if the government will judiciously follow its implementation. Speaking at the 2017 post-budget review by the Ghana Chamber of Commerce and Industry, Professor Bukwin said the abolished taxes and reliefs can engineer economic growth.
The 2017 budget aims at building a business-friendly environment through private sector development. The government introduced a number of policies. The government therefore introduced a number of policies and abolished some taxes to bring relief to the private sector. These include the 1% special import levy, Kayaye market tolls, 17.5% VAT on financial services, 17.5% VAT on selected imported medicines that are not produced locally, 17.5% VAT on domestic airline tickets, special petroleum tax rate also reduced from 17.5% to 15%, national electrification levy reduced from 5% to 3%, public lighting levy reduced from 5% to 2%. The Ghana Chamber of Commerce Forum was therefore held to elicit the views of experts as well as the members of the chamber and how industry can take advantage of these tax reliefs. Nana Apiejay Dankawoso is president of the Ghana Chamber of Commerce and Industry.
It is the expectation of the Ghana National Chamber of Commerce on behalf of the private sector that the following issues will be addressed by the government. What debt management strategy will government pursue to ensure debt sustainability as well as reduce the amount of government's borrowing which results in crowding out the private sector? What is government's strategy to ensure access to credit for the private sector to reliable power supply?
The chief executive of Dalex Financial Service, Mr. Ken Thompson, said though some of the taxes that have been reviewed and abolished are laudable, there are others that will have little impact on industry.
Now, I've called it masquerade tax because either the focus is very limited or the impact is negligible. Tax relief on airlines. Wouldn't it have been better to put the tax relief on VIP or Trotro? 5% tax on sales of property. But nobody was paying the tax. Nobody paid that tax. So it was pointless, really. The effect is zero. Spare parts, not bad. You sell spare parts. You have a small factory. Not bad. Good tax. Can impact private sector. Reduces your cost. We're excited. Excise duty on petroleum reduced from 17.5 to 15%. Good tax. Helps you reduce your cost. National Electrification Scheme levy from 5% to 3%. Not bad.
The head of the finance department of the University of Ghana Business School, Professor Alufa Bokpin, said the budget is embedded with a lot of policies that will help ginger growth in the private sector.
While government signals certain interventions in the system, it's an opportunity for the private sector to run with it. I hope that is okay. So my Ken talked about one district, one what? One factory. These are things that the private sector can actually what? Capitalize on, because government over the years is inefficient in running what? Businesses. So these are opportunities. So it will be important for the private sector to run with the budget. What are the opportunities? And I want to believe that because government has signaled their intention to boost growth by cutting the private sector, they will be amenable to your discussions.
They, however, cautioned the government to keep its eyes on the risk in the system to ensure that the implementation of the One District, One Factory project is not derailed.
And away from the budget, the newly unveiled commemorative 5-cedi note is in circulation. But for the Independence holiday, the new 5-cedi note, which was outdoored on Friday, 3rd March, would have been in circulation by yesterday. The note, which was released to mark the bank's 60th anniversary, has already been distributed to banks across the country. The new 5-cedi note comes with a new pulsating shine when tilted. It also has the portrait of legendary Ghanaian educationist James Kwadri Agri and has enhanced security features, some of which aid the visually impaired in easy identification. The new notes will be used alongside the old 5-cedi notes. Meanwhile, the Bank of Ghana has closed down operations of Agro Development Fund Services Limited until further notice. The central bank says it earlier sent a notice to the general public warning of the unlicensed deposit-taking business it transacts. BOG says it has investigated thoroughly and concluded that its activities are contrary to Section 45A of Act 930. Regarding Hebron Financial Investment Limited, the bank says it is engaged in unauthorized online foreign exchange policies. Trading business. This, the bank says, is contrary to the Foreign Exchange Act. The central bank says anyone who does business with either Agro Development Fund Services Limited or Hebron Financial Investment Limited does his or her own risk. Let's go to the interbank market, where the pound is selling at 5.52 cedis, the US dollar at 4.51 cedis, and the euro going for 4.76 cedis. We also bring you latest prices of major commodities on the international market. And that'll do for business.
Welcome back to the health segment. Following a report by GBC24 about the plight of the 34-year-old mother of four whose two sons need treatment for cataract, Dr. Agarwal Eye Hospital in Accra has offered to do the surgeries for free. Officials of the hospital invited the children for preliminary examinations. A report by Sarah Ofori.
Dr. Agarwal Eye Hospital has about 60 years' experience in specialist care and is present in 14 countries across the globe. The hospital is on record to have performed the world's first anterior segment eye transplant in India on a four-month-old baby to correct corneal disorder. Its branch in Accra also provides high-tech diagnostic and treatment equipment for a comprehensive eye care. It is also specialized in cataract surgery, glaucoma and retinal surgery, corneal treatment, pediatric ophthalmology, laser treatment, among others. Touched by the plight of the 34-year-old mother of four, whose two sons require cataract treatment, officials of the hospital offered to do the surgeries for the children free of charge. The children were examined first by pediatric ophthalmologist Dr. Aati Hida, followed by the retinal specialist Dr. Asiwome Senyaja.
You observe from just looking at him, he's got what we call nystagmus. That means the eye shaking. You see this mainly with people who have problems from childhood. That means the visual pathway, that means the developmental process of the eye has been disturbed from childhood.
He explains the type of treatment required by the 17-year-old Samuel Ahuja.
He has had cataract surgery in both eyes. In the right eye, very good cataract surgery, actually, very good, yeah. Although there is some opacity of the lens which we put inside the capsule, a membrane behind the lens is turning to be a little bit gray due to the lens cover that they left behind where the artificial lens sits on. So all that we do is to just go and use laser to cut the capsule and opening, then vision usually comes back. This is what is so important. Despite the fact that the back of the eye is excellent, he is still not able to see
as
somebody who is normal because the operation was done late.
In the case of one-year-old Eric Ahuja, Dr. Asiwome Senyaja says the presence of the whitish spots in the pupil is not enough to draw conclusion on cataracts.
You see, this child also has the movement of the eye. It shows that either he was born like that or he came out with these changes soon after he came to the world. So we can see the pupil is also white in both eyes, but we don't conclude in such cases that this is cataract. We need to rule out many things because white people, like I said in the other previous interview, can be a cancer.
To determine the absence of any infection within the eye, an advanced test was run.
And this is scanning through the back of the eye. It's not very easy with children, but I've seen that he's doing very well. The first picture already shows that it's a good sign. Okay. We can't see anything much. The advantage of this particular ultrasound we call B-scan, it actually records as a video. So even the child is moving, you could even play the video and then select whatever you want. Just show that the back behind the lens, there is nothing going on there. It's very important because of tumors, because of the retina which could be detached. Then we can, to some extent, estimate the prognosis, at least 40 to 50%.
After the surgery is the task of aftercare, which Dr. Senaja says could be daunting.
Doing the surgery is the easiest part. But when the aftercare after surgery, that's the most difficult part. Sometimes these children don't use the eye from birth. They develop what we call lazy eye. There is a separate treatment for that. But that becomes meaningful when we do give them glasses to balance. And as a child, the eyeballs continues to grow and change in shape. But when we put in a lens, we put in one lens. So we need to keep checking every 6 months to see whether the glasses are still fitting. Yeah. Otherwise, we would have done nothing.
In spite of the interventions available to them, vision would not be 100% clear, Dr. Senaja warns.
Amblyopia is very difficult we just call it lazy eye. Yeah. Although lazy eye meant for many things, but in this sense is that when your child is born and you have not used the eye, or something obstructs the vision, the child doesn't develop the vision. And when the child grows, it remains impaired. So what we normally do is we need to correct that as early as possible. This includes cataract, like we've seen, even squint, and many other diseases that needed to be treated at early stage. So long as the vision is not good, that disease called amblyopia will set in. It's practically the brain suppressing the vision development.
Dr. Senaja prescribes some therapies to stimulate vision after operating on the baby.
Soon after the operation, then we have to do what we call visual stimulation. Visual stimulation is try to stimulate the visual pathway. Normally what we do is that we put toys, sometimes toys with light, then the child plays with it. And through that process, the child tends to learn how to use the eye.
Satisfied with the prognosis of the boys, what is now left is to confirm how well the heart of the one-year-old Erica Hoja will respond to anesthesia prior to the surgery. Sarah Fori, GBC24, Accra.
Well, coming up in this bulletin, the international news, sports and entertainment.
Good evening, let's talk sports. I'm Theophilus Sampa. Boxing legend Azuma Nelson has handed the 68th Independence Day celebration torch to officials of the Traditional Council. The short torch will embark on a relay throughout the 10 regions of the country and return to a starting point on March 6, 2018.
The World Boxing Hall of Famer Azuma was the first Ghanaian to bear the torch after it was used to light the perpetual flame by President Akufo-Addo. The torch will embark on a nationwide relay. Some chiefs, opinion leaders and Ghanaians from all walks of life are expected to be part of the relay.
I believe that this torch is going to rekindle our commitment to work, to make Ghana to work again. From here, it is going to the Western region, then it will continue to the other regions, and we come to Accra finally. I have the belief that by the time that this torch goes around the country and comes back, Ghanaians have awakened to work very hard to make Ghana a paradise.
It's going to the other regions and then come back to Accra finally. This touch is going to bring everything that is down or that is dead up in the nation.
Azuma Nelson, nicknamed the Professor, is a symbol of Ghanaian excellence, having won 3 world titles and ruled the featherweight division of an extended period during his 47-fight career.
So the first sports fan bazaar for first and second cycle institutions in Accra has been held. The initiative by the Senior Staff Association of the National Sports Authority, NSAE, was to create awareness for all the 41 disciplines under their control.
Taekwondo, judo, volleyball, scrabble, tennis, handball, chess, table tennis, badminton, kids athletics, weightlifting, arm wrestling, kickboxing, and basketball featured prominently in the first sports fan bazaar for students from the first and second cycle institutions in the capital. The idea by the Senior Staff Association of the National Sports Authority, NSA, came after research conducted by the National Sports Authority revealed that most Ghanaians have little or no idea about most of the sporting disciplines practiced in the country. This thus pushed the Senior Staff Association to create awareness for all disciplines practiced in Ghana. The chairman of the Senior Staff of the National Sports Authority told us the significance of the National Sports Bazaar.
We have a crop of athletes being phased out. We need others to replace them. And to get others to replace them, we must get the interest of the young ones upcoming to indulge themselves in this sports. And I believe that their interest is being whipped up, and going forward we have a lot of kids, getting involved in the various sporting disciplines that we have.
Some students called for more of such programs.
I've seen it on television, but I've never had done it before. I thought it was only for Togo, because I saw it for almost all the time, Togo. So when I came to see it, I was surprised, and I actually won, and I'm glad.
I played some of the chess. I've seen people playing it on television, but I've never played it before. I didn't even know the names of the different symbols on the chess. But today I know them. I know the king, the queen, and other members, other symbols in chess.
An official of the NSA, Mr. George Bankole, said the purpose for the event has been achieved.
Instead of us catching them young, we wait until they grow before we start teaching them the basic rudiment of the games. But we have decided that henceforth we'll be organizing this thing so that we catch them young and we impart into them the basic techniques of the various games.
The event was partnered by the National Sports Authority and the Ministry of Education and is expected to be held annually and extended to other regions in the country. The event was on the theme, Sports, a tool for discipline, career and academic excellence.
That's all for sports.
Hello, good evening. Time for the arts news. My name is Valerie Danso. The Foridom exhibition is part of a series of artwork that tells the story of Ghanaian heritage. Sculptures in the exhibition represent servants who accompany royals to life after death. Kwame Akotobamfo is the brain behind the Nchinchim project.
Kwame Akotobamfo is an extremist when it comes to arts. He is an expert in both digital and traditional media fine arts. Kwame explains the rationale behind the Foridom exhibition.
This exhibition is called Foridom exhibition. Four is a French word for false or fake. So I replace the free in the freedom with foe, that is fake freedom, and it's meant to be an intervention to our celebration so that we get to have the dialogue in our communities about what we are celebrating about. We are celebrating independence. So is it meaningless if some of our African countries are in trouble with their colonial masters? We don't have fair trade. We are fighting with GMOs, you know. We are fighting with our heritage. You can't wear your own traditional hairstyle to your to the school in your own country. Are you really free? So that is what this exhibition is about.
The Freedom exhibition was planned to coincide with the celebration of Ghana's 60th independence anniversary.
These heads were done mostly by women to help, and for royals, to help accompany the dead royal to Asamado, that's the underworld. So I knew exactly when I planned this that it will somehow coincide with Ghana's 60th anniversary. So we were working hard so that around this time we could use these heads as a medium of communicating and then sparking the dialogue about our freedom.
The Ancestral Project is meant to help the youth to connect all the dots of our ancestral details that was lost due to colonial rule. The sculptures are being made in faces, heads first.
The heads that you see, they are actually incomplete. They are supposed to be full human beings. And they were supposed to be part of a section of my Nchinchim installation.
Financing such a project, Kwame tells us, is not an easy task.
There's a lot of problems with financing because what Ancestor Project does goes beyond art. And we are doing a lot of teaching and community engagement. The artworks on their own, they cost a lot of time and money. They go through a lot of processes.
The sculptures have been displayed at the Kwame Nkrumah Mausoleum.
The family of disqualified Big Brother Niger housemate Kemen have registered their displeasure on his disqualification from the ongoing reality TV show. Kemen was disqualified and asked to leave the Big Brother house as a result of breaking the statutory rules of the game by making...